Welcome back. We are going over to 680. Mike Eppel, he joins us back. And when I say to 680, I mean his remote studio in, we think, is his basement. Good morning, Mike.
That's exactly right. Good morning, Melanie. How are you?
Doing well. So you are back to reality, unfortunately, and there is a lot of heavy content to sift through.
There sure is.
Of that, of course, flowing over into the business world. So let's begin there with what's going on in the U.S.
Yeah, it's almost absurd to see, to some extent, what the markets are doing this morning, considering the visuals that we saw over the weekend, the civil unrest, the protests sweeping America, and yet in all the financial markets at one point today were actually on the rise. I mean, you just kind of disconnect the two, or try to at least, because of the reality of what's going on in the States right now. Mm-hmm. At the same time, you know, you're looking at an economy that was theoretically poised to reopen. And a lot of big name retailers are saying, well, because of the damage done to certain stores, you know, you saw the scenes of Target stores, for example, being vandalized. Starbucks, some of their locations in Seattle were hit. Apple, Walmart, CVS, Target stores, I think some Starbucks locations will stay closed temporarily. And Amazon says it is adjusting some of its delivery routes because they want to, make sure that they don't get caught up in the protest hotspots, so to speak. And, you know, this is, again, just something else that the markets are kind of looking at and going, okay, this is another economic issue that is in the near term. And then you look overseas, you've got economies reopening in Europe. Mm-hmm. Markets are way up there. And then Hong Kong was the focal point for much of last week, with the rising tensions with China and the U.S. interaction there. Hong Kong's market today was up 4%. So it's remarkable to see how things are playing out. The talk this morning out of China is that they're now starting to look at, again, not buying U.S. soy exports. You know, that was one of the targets that China was focused on during the U.S.-China trade battle that, you know, was, of course, now about a year and a half ago, I suppose. And then last week as well, we had the Huawei ruling, Meng Wanzhou. Did that affect and will continue to affect Canadian canola exports into China? So you've got a lot of interplay here in the global economy that is taking place, and certainly a lot of uncertainty.
Yeah, we were definitely covering all of this last mm-hmm. week, and knowing that this was to come, and unfortunately this is not the end. So we will be watching this in the days, weeks to come. Today is June the 1st, and so for a lot of people, rent day, we look at that. We also look at tax filing deadline day.
Yeah, that was supposed to be April 30th, right? But, of course, the pandemic threw everything up in the air, and the CRA said, okay, push back the tax filing, because that is certainly not a focal point for most. So many Canadians unemployed. And this Friday, actually, we'll get another statistical point on that, incidentally, with the May unemployment statistics from Ottawa. But even if you don't file, you've still got until September 1st to pay without penalty. So the federal government is trying to make it as easy as possible for Canadians to weather the storm, because, you know, it's what, 4 or 5 million people out of work right now, and or seeing their hours greatly reduced. If you are receiving any of the CERB benefits or any of the temporary relief measures, that'll be on next year's filing and could be subject to a tax clawback depending on how things go for the rest of the year.
Gotcha. Okay, finally, the federal government looking to promote travel within Canada, which is going to be difficult. You know, a lot of people not necessarily wanting to hop on planes. That is not in their priority list. So how are they going about doing this?
Well, the focus of this cash previously was to attract foreigners to come to Canada over the summertime and spend money here for tourism. But in this case, borders are closed. We want to keep people, you know, more or less at home. If you're going out, support local businesses. And the tourism industry, let's face it, has been worldwide crushed under the weight of the pandemic. Canadian travel and tourism companies are obviously feeling that as well. So they're talking about, you know, millions of dollars in domestic promotion to keep Canadians at home. And at the same time, if you're planning to travel, and I don't even know to what extent you can travel this summer. I think people are kind of saying, where exactly can we go and what is there to do? You know, provincial and national parks are reopening, but just for day use, so you're not talking about camping specifically. But nevertheless, they're looking at least funneling some of the money that would typically be spent on attracting people to come into the country for travel purposes, you know, redirecting it to those travel industry businesses here in Canada who need the support, whether it is actually from, you know, actual travel or not.
Definitely a hurting industry right now, as many are. All right, Mike, as always, we appreciate your time. Nice to have you back.
Thank you.
Thank you.